Hello, I'm Dr. Swati Naik, and once again, welcome back on Emcure AICOG TV, live from Bhubaneswar. I'm pleased to have with me Dr. Sheela Mane. She's one of my favorite teacher, and she's a professor and she's practicing at Anugraha Nursing Home in Bangalore. Thanks a lot, ma'am, for joining us on Emcure AICOG TV. We are going to have some very good insights from madam on the topic of postpartum hemorrhage. I think the topic is very, very critical to every obstetrician and gynecologist because it's very difficult to predict. We need to prepare and we need to respond in time so that we don't have a maternal mortality because of the condition, which is easily treatable and manageable. So let me begin with the first question, ma'am. Why do you think the PPH is on rise, and why do we come to an end result of a maternal mortality with PPH?
Thank you for the invitation. Really speaking, it is not on the rise. Even today, the maternal mortality in India, postpartum hemorrhage is the major cause. And the irony is that postpartum hemorrhage is preventable. So what is more important today is that we have to take all the precautions to see to it that we prevent postpartum hemorrhage. Now all of us, we know about active management of third stage of labor. We do practice that. But it happens sometimes that even though we are practicing, and we call it as AMTSL, which prevents atonic PPH almost in 70% of the cases. But even though we know the risk factors and we have predicted, it can still happen. So what is more important is that we have to be prepared. It is not only the mortality, but also the morbidity. Because if the patient is losing blood, she becomes anemic, and then she can have many problems due to this. The comorbidities can come, like anemia, then sepsis, failure of lactation, and then the woman remains anemic even later on in the postnatal period. So it is very important that not only the mortality just it causes, but also the morbidity, we have to look into that to see to it that we diagnose it in time and we are prepared to handle it, because that is very important to prevent the mortality and morbidity.
Ma'am, how do we predict? I mean, if a patient is coming to me on a regular antenatal care, what's those that my suspicion factors wherein I would predict that this is likely to end up in a postpartum hemorrhage? Is there anything or?
No, in India, like if we look at, we have a different scenario. Most of the women are anemic, they are small made, and also the hypertension in pregnancy. Now these three factors again make them vulnerable to have postpartum hemorrhage. Like the regular definition of postpartum hemorrhage is 500 ml of blood loss in a vaginal delivery, if it is more than that. But for these women, even if the blood loss is 350 ml, it matters, because they can show the signs of hypovolemia with this much. That is one thing. The other predicting factors will be other high risk factors, like if they have multiple pregnancies, if they have they are multigravidas, if they have polyhydramnios associated, if they are elderly, and if they are obesity. All these factors come into, and also if suppose we have induced labor. So these are the things which are the risk factors which can lead to. So we have to be better prepared and be careful in these cases.
Absolutely. So the risk factor identification.
Yeah, and also the abnormal placentas like placenta previa and adherent placenta, if we have diagnosed early, we have to be really better prepared. And these type of cases like placenta previa and adherent placenta, it is better we manage in a tertiary care center where all the facilities are available. The blood bank backup is there. It is very important because these patients, they can have massive hemorrhage.
Absolutely. So one needs to be very, very vigilant with those risk factors coming into picture. Ma'am, what is the golden hour in the management of postpartum hemorrhage where one needs to be really on toes? What do you have to say?
See, the golden hour starts the moment we diagnose postpartum hemorrhage.
Right.
And from that time, every minute is important.
Right.
It's not that we wait for an hour. Like for a neonatologist, every second is important. When the neonatologist is resuscitating the baby in that 1 minute, that way every minute. So in that golden hour, the main aim for postpartum hemorrhage is arrest bleeding. So we start our oxytocin drill, we do bimanual compression, we can do aortic compression. So do all the measures to see to it that we arrest bleeding. Because if we arrest the bleeding, then the patient will not bleed, she will not go into hypovolemic shock. And it is very important that clinically we have to assess. Now we have to do the blood loss assessment. We know that it is very subjective, but we can also assess clinically. And one simple measure to assess the blood loss clinically is shock index. Okay. Shock index is heart rate divided by systolic blood pressure.
Okay.
Now, always the heart rate is lesser than the systolic blood pressure. Once the patient starts bleeding, there is hypovolemia. In a normal person, the shock index is 0.5 to 0.7. Once, and in a pregnant woman, it is 0.7 to 0.9. Mm-hmm. If it goes beyond 0.9, that means she is hypovolemic.
Mm-hmm.
If it is 1.2, that means already she has lost 30% of blood.
Oh, really?
And if that 30% of blood loss, if we do not correct, okay? And it is a very simple measure. Even those who are at the remote places or in the periphery, they know that the patient has problem, and this simple measure can tell you, and immediately you can take action and correct. So in golden hour, as I said, oxytocin. Now we use oxytocin, we use carboprost, we use misoprostol, as well as we use ergometrine. Now the new drug which is come now is the tranexamic acid after the woman trial. And earlier we used to, the WHO recommendation was that to use only in a traumatic postpartum hemorrhage. But now the JAPAICO and the woman trial have told us that use it as early as possible.
Absolutely. We irrespective of the cause of the bleeding.
Yes. Irrespective. Yeah. 1 gram. Yeah. Either you can push it slowly over a period of 10 minutes or it can be added to 100 ml of normal saline and you give it. And it really helps. Yeah. So now again, tranexamic acid is there, and we have found that if we use it quickly, they say that if it is used within 3 hours, it reduces the mortality by 30%, which will be a really a large number.
Yeah.
Okay. Apart from that, other measures, whatever we have to do, like the balloon tamponade, we can do simple measure, that is compression from inside. Then we can use a life wrap, that is anti-shock garment. If it is applied to the lower part of the body, it prevents the blood loss, and also it shifts the blood from the periphery to the vital organs like the heart and lung, and patient's blood pressure can be maintained till the help arrives, till the blood arrives. Because it's very important. Once the patient is losing, we do not have blood, immediately give IV fluids, particularly isotonic fluids like either RL or a normal saline. No question of giving 5% dextrose here. We have to give at least 1:3. In that ratio, but not too much also, because that can cause washout phenomenon and coagulation, coagulopathy because of the washout phenomenon. The blood, yes, it's very important that if you are in a remote place, at least you have a blood storage facility. If the patient is Rh negative, be careful, know her group, get the people, I mean the blood cross matched and kept in the blood bank ready, so that in case of an emergency, or at least the donor is ready who has been cross matched, so that you can ask the person to come and donate the blood. So these are the things which need to be kept ready. So what is important is, I always say that postpartum hemorrhage is prevent or predict, prepare and handle. So one has to be well prepared so that in golden hour we do not land up with problems.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. I think the key message coming up is a shock index, which I have heard from very few people, and it's a very easily doable in clinic tool that will guide you what exactly is the percentage of the blood loss
and how is the clinical condition
of the patient. Yes. Second thing is the role of tranexamic acid, which has been raised up by all the guidelines, including WHO. Earlier the better. And the third thing, I think one need to be very vigilant, and I think you were referring to the pneumatic
anti-pneumatic
shock garment. Okay, so that's a new thing that is coming up.
It's
for
not new actually, it is already there, but it's not been used in a country like India, where if you look at the maternal death review, which every state is doing, and if you look at that, you will find that the maximum deaths are due to postpartum hemorrhage, and they are happening in transit.
Transit, right.
So it is very important in remote places when the blood is not available, you apply the garment and shift the patient. At least she reaches to the hospital
in a stable condition.
And not in a irreversible shock. So Tamil Nadu is the only state which is using it at all levels, I think. And we all know that Tamil Nadu has already achieved MDG goal 5.
Oh, nice.
I think we don't have to look at others. There are so many states with whom, I mean, we can collaborate and learn lessons from them.
Because, definitely, ma'am. Thank you so much for sharing all those wonderful views on the management of PPH. Thanks a lot for joining us on Emcure AICOG TV. Thank you
and
so much.
And one more message I would like to give your friends. I take this opportunity to invite you all to Bangalore in 2019 for AICOG from 8th January to 12th January. Now, our logo is Women's Health is Nation's Wealth.
Wow.
So it is very important that we take care of our girls and women in our country. Thank you very much.